Okay, I think we can start. First presentation is application of data analysis methods in the development of integration tools for platforms of supercomputer modeling of the rocket of the acoustic field of a cosmodrome at rocket launch. I can share the screen now. Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
So originally this work was done by my MSc student. He will defend this work 2 weeks later, and I will do presentation to you. The idea of this work is to incorporate several mathematical models in one simulation, because usually in real life we have to account for different scales and different effects in one simulation. Here is an example, launch of a Vega rocket at the Kourou airport or spaceport. Within this work, we will study how noise propagates from rocket nozzle, how it reaches the upper parts of rocket, and how the noise could be mitigated, how the noise could be the injection. As you can see, the computational domain is very large, and if you try to measure how much volume inside the computational domain, it will be approximately 234,000 cubic meters. And if we compare this size to characteristic size of grid cell, which is 1.5 multiplied by 10 of minus 5 cubic meters, we get the ratio between volume of computational domain and volume of characteristic cell volume. This ratio is about 15 billions, and it will take about 85 years to simulate 1,000 cores. So it is not acceptable, and we have to introduce some assumptions. We have our computational domain to reduce this time to some reasonable values. So we are always balancing between two, actually between three values, accuracy, time, and resources. Here I will speak only about accuracy and speed. To meet requirements, usually industrial requirements for speed is about 1 or 2 weeks of calculation, not more than 2 weeks of calculation. So to meet these requirements, we decided to separate computational domain in three parts. First part is a development of waves. Second part is the propagation jet and propagation of waves inside the jet. And third part is the propagation of these waves to upper part of the rocket. In this case, I will show you later, the complexity of the model reduces significantly, and we can simulate the process in 1 or 2 weeks. First of all, we have to understand how noise is generated, and by analyzing possible mechanisms for noise sources, we can find that main sources of noise during rocket launch is large-scale turbulent flow structure, shockwave structure interaction. And this noise could be suppressed by what? And all noise sources are generally governed by instabilities, by mainly by Kelvin and Coulomb's instability, which arises between two medium with different speed. If we and if we want to reduce the noise, we can inject water in the gas stream, and with water we can remove energy from gas stream, and thus we can remove mean energy from ordered coherent structure, and thus we can lower fluctuations of pressure, and we can reduce total noise. And if we talk about removal of mechanical energy with water, this effect could be estimated using some integral approaches which were developed several decades in NASA. But there is another way of noise suppression is the destruction of large coherent structures. And this effect cannot be predicted using integral approaches. So it can be predicted only using numerical simulation. The another one important thing in simulation is the development of liquid jets and disintegration of this liquid jet in droplet, which then take energy from gas jet. Because the ratio of how fast this process governs how much energy we will take from gas jet, and thus it governs how much the noise will be suppressed. So we have to account for Kelvin Kilcoyne instability at gas jet. We have to account for Kelvin Kilcoyne instability at liquid jets because it acts as a primary disintegration tool. And then we have to account for relay plateau instability as secondary disintegration tool, which separates droplets into small droplets. Again, I will tell you a bit more about differences between some characteristic scales. For example, the length of Vega rocket is about 30 meters or 30,000 millimeters. And when we talk about droplets, this is about 50 micrometers. So the ratio between scales is very large. The idea is to make some assumptions. So we don't account noise from water jets because it's relatively small comparing to noise from a gas jet. We do not solve for transport of gas components after exiting the gas duct because mainly everything is mixed already. And we do not account for all droplets because we can simulate droplets as a cloud with varying properties, with varying diameters of droplets. In this way, regions, and inside each regions we will have a separate numerical model. In the first region, we have two models, one model for gas dynamic. This is a model for gas flow plus kinetic energy model, like large eddy simulation model. Second model is a model of droplet dynamics. It's a Lagrangian model, and we have a connection between two models to provide energy and momentum flow from gas dynamic model to droplet model. For model number one, we use static meshes and open form approximation for convective fluxes, for diffusion fluxes, and for time integration. We can reduce, for model two, we can reduce the model to simulation of gas. The geometry is very simple in zone two, we can use another approach for approximation. Namely, we use adaptive meshes and Amrex software for simulation. And it allows us to save resources and to refine grids only in places where it is really needed. And finally, in the last zone, we don't need to account for gas flow, so we have to solve only wave equation with homogeneous right hand side. And thanks to Fox Williams, we can do this simulation using integral approach, which is implemented in Live Acoustics library on the top of OpenFOAM. Just one more assumption. If we know the geometry of bus gas ducts at the left and at the right hand of the rocket are similar, we can guess that noise spectrum from each gas duct is the same. So we don't need to simulate bus gas ducts. We can simulate only one, and then we can add sources from each gas duct using relations for incoherent sources. Now we can look at how our program works. It takes data about geometry of the rocket, about parameters at the nozzle. Then it uses proper orthogonal decomposition to transport data from OpenFOAM to Amrex. And then we use Fox-Wilhelm-Hoching analogy to propagate noise from gas jet to upper point of the rocket. The main difficulty which arises when we try to couple two program is interpolation of data and interpolation of data in space and extrapolation of data in time. And we decided to use data analysis method to solve this test. The idea was very simple. We can use POD to interpolate data in space. And then if we apply discrete Fourier transform to POD time series, we can get spectrum for each POD mode. And with this spectrum, we can extrapolate data in time. So as you can see from the slide, the simulation time in zone one is very small, and simulation time in zone two is much larger. And we can simulate some characteristic time in zone one, and then we can extrapolate this simulation using discrete Fourier for zone number two. The overall, the all models in the complex were validated using various cases such as low Reynolds jet simulation, high Reynolds jet simulation, monopole source, dipole sources simulation, and so on. So we were certain that at least each part of the model works correctly. Two cases were selected for demonstration of the program. One case is a simulation with water, and one case simulation without water. Thankfully to rocket, there is a user's manual which contains all needed information to run the case. On this slide, we can see a sketch of the domain. Here is a control surface between two zones, and here is a sketch for simulation case with water supply. Okay, I can sort out most of the slides. As a result, we got noise from two sources, from bus gas ducts. If you want, you can see that in one zone takes approximately 7 to 10 days. In the second zone, simulation takes about 3 days. And in the third zone, the simulation takes about 1 hour. After running the simulation, we were able to study the reduction of noise. The reduction was about 5 decibels, which is in good agreement with the prediction by Max Kandula from NASA. So at least an energy flow from all models work correctly. And I can show another one slide with the result of POD between two zones. I have can you hear the can you see the presentation?
Yeah, so we can see the presentation.
Okay, so we made POD decomposition between two zones. For example, you can see UX is a horizontal component of the velocity, and you can see near the digit zero average velocity, and under other digits.
We can only see the older PPT.
Oh, you see only older?
So yeah, we only see the older PPT.
Okay, I will start a new one. Okay, now can you see?
Yeah, we can see it now.
Yes. So with POD, we were able not only to couple different tools, different numerical simulation tools, but we were able to study how, for example, water injection influences structures of the flow, how it influences the mean picture and the fluctuating picture. For example, you can see horizontal component of the velocity without water, and we can compare it to horizontal component. It's a vertical, I'm sorry. Ux is a vertical component. And as you can see, while average flow is very similar, so the patterns near digits zero are very similar, but patterns for mode number 2 and 3 are different. And the same picture we can get from for UY. UY is a horizontal velocity. So without water, maximum velocity is 1,200. And yeah, for example, you can see for mode number 1, some revolving flow when gas goes outside in the upper and inside in the bottom of the rectangle. And if we compare to vertical component with water, we can see that the structure changed completely. For the further work, we can try to find, for example, correlations between these changes in structure between two zones and, for example, between noise generated from jet. Sorry for the long presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, I have questions. I'm not sure I fully understand your presentations. If I'm wrong, you can correct me. I'm thinking maybe you use ARES to simulate the jet flow. I mean the gas jet flow, and then use a POD to create some kind of noise generator or noise creator, and then use FWH to solve the noise. Is that correct?
Not exact. I used POD to interpolate data between OpenFOAM and Amrex. And OpenFOAM was a simulator for high-speed multi-component and multi-phase flow. And Amrex is a simulator for jet, for fast. And I used POD as interface between two models. And FFT was used to extrapolate data in time.
Okay.
So if you decompose the data on the surface between two models using POD, you will get spatial and temporal modes. And I used spatial modes for interpolation. And if you decompose temporal modes into spectrum using DFT, then you can use it for extrapolation, for prediction on large times.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, I have no questions. And how to determine the snapshot intervals and the numbers of snapshots?
Actually, we have information about about maximum frequencies which have to be captured by our model. On the other hand, each mode is associated with some with some number of frequencies. So we cut off some all modes which have frequencies larger than specified range. Did I answer your question or not?
Okay, thank you. And another question is, how do you find the relationship and the physical phenomenon?
Sorry, I didn't get it.
When you COD, how do you find the relationship between the modes and the physical phenomenon?
We use visual analysis, so I can show you picture. If I get you correctly. For all modes, we can see the spectrum, and our cutoff frequency is about 2000. So usually when you finish the simulation, you can see that the higher number of the frequency. So we cut off all high frequency modes. Did I answer it? No. Can you hear me?
Matthew, I think you can continue. Maybe okay. We encounter some network problem.
Okay, if I'm correct, his question was about how we make link between frequency and mode. So we just look at FFT spectrum and see which modes belongs to desired frequencies range.
Next time, maybe we can just type the questions in the chat, so everybody can clearly see, understand the questions.
Okay.
Sorry, excuse me. Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Okay. In your old slide, page 21. And in your zone one, you use open form to simulate. And I want to know the guys and you open form to simulate. And I want to ask how do you capture the interface model, interface capturing model?
Yes, this. I understand question. No,
yeah.
I didn't capture the interface because actually I assumed that the most of the energy transported from gas to fluid when fluid disintegrated in droplets. So For many cases, I don't need to resolve interface between gas and fluid because I need to resolve only droplets as clouds. I can show you one picture.
Okay.
Here you can see different nozzles. We found interesting work by several authors, and they showed that despite any kind of mass flow rate or any shape of the nozzle, the distribution could be the same if you use Weber number, discharge pressure, and I think that's all. So Weber number is and discharge pressure is the main parameters. So I don't simulate the primary disintegration. I simulate only secondary disintegration from single droplets.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, if there is no question, maybe we can go to next talk by Sergei Strizhak, and his presentation is Actuate a line model for simulation of onshore wind turbines in model wind farm. Sergei, are you here?
Yes, hello, I'm here. So I try to share my presentation. Do you hear me and do you see my slides on the screen?
Yes, we can see you.
Okay, hello. Hello everyone. My name is Sergei Strizhak, and today I will do a short presentation. You can see the title of my presentation. Actuator line model for simulation of onshore wind turbines in model wind farm. So this is the contents of, I will do a short introduction to the topic of wind energy. I will tell a little bit about open source software library, which is called SOFA. I will share some information about large eddy simulation method. Then tell about what is actuator line model. We'll show you some results of our simulation. We'll talk a little bit about our new solver and do some conclusions. So the wind energy is a very important topic now, and it is part of renewable energy direction. In many countries of the world, this direction is very popular, and it is very stable, and it still grows. Among these countries are Denmark, Germany, Netherlands, Spain, United States, China, India. And Russia is just at the beginning state. We have some new projects with new farms, and they are located only on as onshore, on the territory of the large territory of Russian Federation. But we have also a potential projects for offshore wind farms. There are different scientific groups in the world, and some of them are shown here. It's a Technical University of Denmark, it's a Johns Hopkins University in the United States, and some others. There are different manufacturers, very large and very strong companies. Among them, Vestas, it's maybe one of the largest. You can see Sinovel from China. And now we have a new direction in Rosatom company. So there are different projects, research projects. There are some commercial codes. And here you can see general topics for wind energy. Among them are the studying of new materials and structures, then wind and turbulence, aerodynamics, control and system identification, some others. But the main trend now is in the field measurement, in collection of new data, and development of new mathematical models and running them on HPC, high performance computer. If we talk about the direction or the topic for wind and turbulence and aerodynamics, the most scientific challenging tasks are that wind gusts are not taken into account. There is some problems with the definition of the value of turbulence intermittency. This is a very important parameter to study the energy spectrum of turbulence. Then there is the possibility of development the correct reduced models, then the study the 3D flow patent and their dynamics on the rotor blades, and some topic regarding flow control devices and the reducing of aeroacoustic noise. If we look on this table, we can see that we have to study different lengths. For example, for boundary layer, we need to study, it's a very, very small parameter, like maybe millimeters. And if we want to study the climate research topic, we need to go inside 10 kilometers or 100 kilometers. There are different lengths or values in velocity from 10 up to 100, and time scale is also very different. So we have multi-scale problem. If we talk about the relevance of the topic, we have to mention that we deal with atmospheric boundary layer, which is the layer with the height of 1 or 2 kilometers. Inside the atmospheric boundary layer, we need to study the velocity wind profile, temperature, scalar transport, surface heat fluxes, and diurnal circles. We need to take in account the process of stratification, how the temperature is changed during the, and we also need to pay our attention on onshore and offshore wind farms. This is the example of onshore wind farm, and this is the example of the tower meteorological observation station, which is used for a collection of meteorological data. This is very important, and it contains the direction of the velocity, the value of the velocity, the energy of the velocity, and so on. If we talk about the offshore topic, this is another direction, and this is very important direction, and this is a future in the world. So many countries pay their attention to the offshore potential locations. And here we can see different variations of offshore wind turbines. Some of them, they are bottom fixed. Here we can see three of them. And some of them, they are like a floating offshore wind turbines. We can see here three different models, 1, 2, 3. This is just an information, a short introduction for wind energy topic. We work in our laboratory with open source software, with open form, other software packages, and a part of the open form project, there was a special dedicated project for development of open source library for numerical simulation of flow parameters in wind farms. This library was developed in National Renewable Energy Laboratory, NRL, in Colorado, in United States. And it is supported by National Center of Atmospheric Research. This is the organization who developed a very famous open source code. It's called WRF, Weather Research Forecast Code. And inside this SOFA library, there are different solvers. Some of them are shown here on this slide. The first one is its ABL solver. It is used for studying parameters in atmospheric boundary layer. There are different solvers for wind turbine simulation. There is a couple solver to study FCI, fluid structure interaction problem. For example, using FST special solver. This library contains different models. Among them is large eddy simulation model with different subgrid scale models. And there are special utilities to use or to define the boundary conditions. And we have to study process with different scales. And you can see that the scale is from millimeters to till kilometers. So the Reynolds number is very high. So here we can see some results of simulation for a domain like a parallelepiped. And we did this simulation on our internal HPC cluster. Here we can see the size of the domain, and we used the parameters we took from meteorological station. And here you can see the simulation of TISA turbine foam solver. So if we look inside the mathematical model, It contains finite volume method and large eddy model. We have several equations. Among them are a mass conservation equation, then the momentum equation in the with Businesque approximation. And this equation contains different terms, like the term includes the Coriolis force. Then we can see a term which is responsible for stratification. And we can see also some gradient term for pressure and additional term which is called Fi. Here we can see how we can define the value of omega, and it deals with the planetary rotation rate, which is depends from latitude. A potential temperature transport equation, which is written is here. Here we have additional parameter, which we need to define. Here is a parameter for stress tensor term, and here is a special term for potential temperature, and they link with a subgrid scale turbulent viscosity. If we talk about subgrid scale modeling, we have to understand how to define the SGS Reynolds stresses. There are different models, and among them, the most famous is Smagarinsky SGS model. And in this model, we need to take in account the value of the size of filter. So, and this this parameter is linked with step or the size of the numerical grid. There is also another approach. It's called one eddy equation model. And there is some modification. It's a dynamic Smagarinsky SGS model, which is based on the relation between SGS stresses at different scales. If we go inside the SOFA library, we have a special versions of SGS models. Among them is United Kingdom Meteorological Office Smagarinsky model, and it takes in account the Richardson number. There is also a modification of one equation anisotropic model, and some versions of dynamic Lagrangian Smagarinsky models. If we want to define our problem, we need to correctly calculate the surface shear stress model and define the surface, which is a tower, and it depends from the friction velocity, and it should be followed to the law of Monin-Obuchov, ABL similarity law. Now let's talk a little bit about the representation of our wind turbine. If we talk about this problem, we need to understand that there are different approaches. The first one is to create a numerical grid around three blades. We talk now about the horizontal wind turbine, and it contains three large blades. The first approach is to reproduce or to build a detailed mesh around the blade. It is possible to do, but this approach is very complicated. We need to spend a lot of time for a creation of a numerical grid, follow the rules of Kolmogorov scales, and this grid can be very detailed and very large. And if we talk about the wind farm, please imagine that in wind farm it is possible that we have 60 or 80 wind turbines, and we need to build for each wind turbine blade a very complicated and detailed mesh. And this is very expensive. And in this approach, we have the rotation of internal mesh, which surrounds three blades. The second approach, it's more engineering approach or more simple approach. And in this approach, which was developed in Technical University Denmark, first for Urans, and then it was extended for large eddy simulation models, we represent the blade with actuator line model. So in this case, we represent the blade with points or different sections. And here is just a representation of our three blades with three lines, and each line is reproduced with points or sections. The second approach is called actuator disk point. So we have to change our surface with three blades with a disk, and this disk contains several points. But in our presentation, we talk about only the actuator line model. And in this case, we can look at this picture. Here we can see that we have a two-dimensional we have a two-dimensional section of the blade, and with a airfoil shape at that location. And in this case, we have different airfoils with different characteristics. Here we can see how actuator line model works for mathematical modeling. So we have to keep which goes from this technical device. And here we can reproduce this force like this formula with, for calculation of total aerodynamic force. And it uses the Gaussian kernel function. Here we can see the exponent and additional parameter. And this additional parameter is a special parameter which is called smoothing weights. And we have to pay our attention how to calculate this parameter, because it influences on numerical stability. And here we can see also that we have the possibility, or we need to define the aerodynamic coefficients. And these coefficients should be defined as a table data for each section or for each profile. And for example, we need to study these parameters in advance and change angle of attack from minus 180. And we have to use different kind of airfoil profiles. And it's necessary to have this data. And of course, we have to understand in advance which kind of airfoil profiles we plan to use when we want to describe our wind turbine. On this slide, we can see that we have a picture of airfoil with a triangle of the velocity, and there are two different two-dimension section, airfoil section is shown, where Ux and Uy are the velocity vector components projected on the local coordinate system. URL is the magnitude of the velocity projected on the plane, and the added rotational component, R is the radius of our blade, omega is the rotational speed, where we use omega multiply by R. And we have also to use alpha as an angle of attack, and alpha TW is the twist angle for wind blade. And we need to calculate the value of lift force and the value of D of drag force. And here you can see two formulas. And C is the height of our airfoil section, and W is the actuator section. And finally, we need to calculate the value of F, which is the sum of L and D. And if we return to this previous slide, we can see that this this value, F eta actuator, this value is for special airfoil. We can use maybe only one airfoil profile to define our wind turbine. But if you can see here, we have very complicated surface with several. So we used our approach with SOFA and tried to verify it on famous blind test experiments. And for example, there are data from NTNU Trondheim, Norway, And they provided some experiments with a single wind turbine and a couple wind turbines. And we have the access to all data. And these are low turbulence in form in flow, high turbulence in form in flow, how tight turbulence shear in flow, the parameters from the blades, the location, and so on. Here we can see the data for our model wind turbine. And here we can see the airfoil section. And in this case, we used only a single airfoil, which is NRL SA826. And we have some data for coefficients for CL, which is for lift drag and for drag force. And then we created a numerical domain, a numerical grid. So we defined the reference value. We defined the value for rotation. This is a dimensionless rotation. And the Reynolds number you can see here. The numerical domain was defined with these values in meters. So, and we want to study the parameters of the velocity, for example, at different sections. And this experimental data were available for us. And we use different kind of meshes for 2, 4, and million cells. And here you can see the results of U magnitude calculation. And it was, we took the data for normalized velocity at x/d equal to this value. And then we tried to compare the results with the results of different scientific groups. You can see they use codes and different commercial codes, in-house codes, and there are also some experimental data. And we used different approaches in our simulation. So here you can see with dot black dots the NTNU experiment, and then here you can see results from SOFA. It's a piece of foam turbine solver, and we used the first approach, and the error was very high, so the results were terrible. And then we did some changes, and then we got a more correct results. And our approach included that we correctly remeshed the solid bodies, like the tower, vertical cylinder, and the horizontal cylinder, it's a nacelle. So we created a very detailed mesh for these two bodies. And after that, we improved our results. And here you can see the coefficients of power, CP, and actual thrust coefficient, CT. This is an integral values, and we need also to compare these results with experiment. And here you can see, again, the results from different teams, and with dot circles, you can see the result from experiment. And we put our points here and try to compare the values for the first wind turbine and then for the second wind turbine, for CP and for CT. We also studied a more complicated case, and we used the data from experiment of University of Sergei. And they studied the 12 wind small wind turbines, and this was an array of 3 wide and 4 deep wind turbines. Studied how the atmospheric boundary layer influence on the parameters, and they studied the stable, unstable, and neutral. So this is a very complicated experiment. And we also use some data. We also reproduced this wind turbine. We did a new grid and domain. You can see here a tower and nacelle, what we reproduced with a block mesh utility and then a refined mesh utility. And then we studied the case with neutral atmospheric boundary layer. And we tried to define the deficit of velocity inside each section. And then we studied the parameters for turbulent parameters inside each section. Here you can see the horizontal velocity profile behind the wind turbine of the central row in different sections. So with a red, you can see our result. It's a and here you can see with dots, it's an experiment. So you can see that in some sections we have good results, but here, for example, this is a very large an error. So we have to study more what we can change. Here, just to show that we also try to define the energy spectrum, and we selected a box, and then we applied utility and define the value of energy and try to compare with the law of Kolmogorov-Obuchov, which is the law of -5/3. So you can see the red line and the results from our calculation. And we also, of course, so far it's what it was have been done by NRL or by community. But now we are in the process of development of new solver, and inside wind farm or atmospheric boundary layer, it's necessary to take in account the motion or the influence of different particles. These particles can be soil particles, small raindrops, and large raindrops, and this is very important concerning ice accretion process on the surface of wind blade, and we need to take in account in the south regions where there are a lot of flying insects. It's, you can see different kind of small flying animals, and they can influence on erosion of the process of the surface of wind blade. It can destroy absolutely fully destroy the surface of wind blade, and we need to study how these flying insects influence. And in this case, we decided to create our own solver, and it is based on ABL solver and a standard solver for simulation of a kinematic parcels. And for example, we can use ICO uncoupled kinematic parcel form. And we created our own solver, it's called ABL solver. And you can see here that we studied the source code form and the different type of classes for description of cloud of particles. For example, kinematic cloud is one of the base class. And after that, we have other classes. And here you can see just a short part of source code. And here you can see additional term. And this term describes the momentum form of particles. And for example, this term, it describes the Coriolis force. So we can add, so open source and open form allows us to do very flexible changes inside the source code and add a new additional submodels. And here you can see, and we try to simulate the case with 14 model wind turbines with solid particles. We just did injection of solid particles during 10 seconds with a fixed mass of particles. So there were also defined the inlet velocity of particles per cell per seconds. We have the velocity of air and also the diameter of particles. And we started to try to understand the distribution of particles in height. So, and here you can see the distribution of number of particles on different positions. And these are results at this time of second. So finally, the conclusion that we have installed so far library on ISP RAS UniCFD cluster. So we have run several cases, among them a blind test case, and we got a really good results case. And we resolved correctly the tower and the nacelle, the hub, for the model wind turbines. And we also studied turbulent statistical parameters. So I don't have any time to show these slides, but yes, we have done it. But of course, it's necessary to study more in details parameters in the wakes, like probability density function of the velocity, statistical of velocity increments, skewness and flatness. So in case of industrial wind farms, here we studied only model wind farms. In case of industrial wind farms, we need to have more domains in size, in meters, or maybe in kilometers. We need to use affine grids, and maybe it's not 10 or 20 millions of cells, it's maybe more. We need to take in account in less model complex terrain and vegetation. So thank you very much for your attention. I finished my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dear colleagues, do you have any questions?
Yeah, I have several questions. These are wonderful presentations. And the first thing I want to ask, this ALM method is a quite attractive method because it's cheap compared to full geometry simulations. And is widely used in wind farm industries. And, but I think for this actuator line method, it's basically replace the geometry with body force. So it might be originally have some drawback. For example, it's highly dependent on experimental data which for this blade. So it might be not that accuracy or not that sensitive to the turbulence flow, turbulence inflow, especially if you put many wind turbine in a line, and the second the downstream wind turbine actually face the very turbulence and unstable flow. At that time, this interaction between the blades is cannot concerned. Is cannot considered. So, in your opinion, is there any ways to improve these things? I mean, to further develop this actuator line method?
Okay, as I understood correctly, we have a question regarding actuator line model and how it's correct reproduce in the flow of inside wind farm. So I may say that for my knowledge, we do have let's say two different approaches. The first one, when we resolved correctly all the scales near the surface of wind turbine, and in this case we need to build as a dedicated mesh which should be rotate with these rotating wind blades. And it's possible, yes, it's possible to do in this way. And there are also some papers and some research works. But in case if we want to study the real industrial wind farm with 100 wind turbines, it's very expensive to run such a what is now really in industry, how it's really goes in industry, because there are maybe 6 or 8 software packages which can be used for wind farm simulation. Inside these software codes, we know that actuator line models and actuator disk model, they were implemented and they were used. They like working horses. So they really used by the developers of the software. And this is a cheaper approach how to reproduce. And the question, yes, there are some many questions. For example, how to select this Gaussian kernel function, how to select the smooth width parameters, how it influence on the ability of numerical simulation. And the trend now that different research groups, they compare different approaches with actuator line model and actuator disk model. And they try to understand which model is more robust or more powerful. But I talked with different people from different scientific teams, and I know that first actuator line model was developed with URANS approach. But when we got a new powerful resources of supercomputers, this approach was adapted inside the large eddy simulation model. Of mm-hmm. course, we need to have the data, data for airfall profiles. We need mm-hmm. to get this data somewhere. It's like our database. And of course, somebody should provide this data for profiles. And for example, the first slide I mentioned different teams from Denmark Technical University, or it's called University Delft University, and they have a database or NRL. They have a database for typical airfall profiles, and they have also the graphics or the data for SL or CD, depends from alpha angle of attack, and we need to use this data. And for my opinion, if we want to start, let's say, not at the beginning, but we need, of course, to verify this data, because we need to do a dedicated simulation case for a single airfoil profile with angle of attack, and try to compare what we really reproduce and if it's correct with experimental data. Other alternatives to actuator line model and actuator disk model. Because if you look inside the different publications of different teams, all of them, they use these two approaches. And so, of course, we need to pay attention on different aspects and how we reproduce, for example, the tau, the Nassel layer, what is the turbulence model, what are the parameters for inflow conditions. Of course, we need to do some additional analysis of the results and maybe do some changes, but it just it's topics for new projects, I think.
I agree. And I think for the actuator disk method, this might be more suitable for marine patella. And another question is, have you considered to combine this wind farm issues with your acoustic library? As I know, the wind farm noise is also another hot topic.
Yes, we. So the question was if we try to study the topic with IR acoustics of wind blades. Yes, we discussed it in detail. And, we have Lib Acoustics library, which is our own software, and we want to combine this so far with Lib Acoustics and try to use maybe different approaches. The first one, it's a Folks William Hawkins analogy for rotating frames. It's another topic. It's one of the topic. And another topic which we also tried to study maybe 2 years ago, 3 years ago, we also studied another method. It's called boundary element method, and we try to use it also for the problem of a space rocket start, to try to study acoustics, and it's possible to study also the acoustic field on the surface from the rotating wind turbine. So it's a possible project for future also, and maybe we come back to this problem in future, but right now we postpone a little bit with this direction due to unavailable resources of people. This is just the problem that we don't have free people resources, and that's all.
And the last question, I think that there may be quite a lot of similarities between wind turbine and a tunnel turbine. So in your opinion, to what extent the experience we accumulate in wind turbine can be transferred to tunnel turbine?
Please repeat the second model.
And in my opinion, there must be many similarities between wind turbine and a tunnel turbine.
Can you describe the second type of turbine? What is it? Because I did not catch.
Tunnel turbine, the turbine in water.
Yes. You mean tidal? Sorry. Yes. It's correct. It's possible. Yes, but it's possible to use a piece of foam turbine solver for tidal turbine in the water. And I think that I remember that there was such project maybe in United Kingdom, in University of Southampton. Maybe I'm not right. Yes, we can.
You're right.
We can.
I saw that. Yeah. I saw
yes. But currently, yes, it's possible. Yes, we can try to look inside this. These approaches can be used for tidal wind turbines in the water, no problem. But currently in Russia, there are, I don't know, maybe it's potential projects in future. But currently,
I see.
We are more focused right now. We try to discuss a potential project for offshore wind turbine, floating offshore wind turbine in the region near Sakhalin, Sakhalin, Iceland. It's located very close to Japan. So we are more focused now on the offshore wind farm, which will be located near the territory of Sakhalin region, and we need to take in account the topic regarding the behavior of floating wind turbine, offshore floating wind turbine, inside the very regular sea waves with a very large height and with a different direction. And the height can be approximately 8 meters. So this is a potential project for us, and we would like to be focused on this direction right now. It's what the customer wants, we try to do. So it's our future.
I see. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. I think that we have covered different aspects. So thank you for your attention, and bye-bye. Matvey, so I have finished.
Okay. Thank you, Sergei. Our next and last talk is Accumulation of Internal Wave Energy in Oceanology by Ilias Sibgatullin. Ilias, are you here?
My screen now, wait a minute.
Okay.
Okay, can you see my presentation now?
Yes.
And you can hear me, yes? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's loud enough, it's okay?
Yes, it's okay.
Okay, thank you. So I will talk about internal and inertial waves. So I will try to speak today in connection with the application to oceanology. Here I mention only a few of causes. It's Evgeny Ermaniuk from Novosibirsk, Thierry Dexua, he is the head of physics laboratory in Ecole Normale Supérieure in University of Lyon. Matvey Kraposhin, Daniil Rizanov, and Kirill Vatutin are from the UniCFD lab, and Maria Providukhina is working in Institute of Oceanology. But actually, more researchers are involved in this study. And for example, here today is present Tatiana Elizarova, and we are collaborating on modeling these in open form with the help of regularized equations. So I will mention it later. Now I will just begin by a description of the scales of oceanology, problems in oceanology. The tides bring to the Earth energy, mechanical energy, about 1 terawatt. And this energy plays quite an important role in not directly, but anyway, it plays quite an important role in climate changes on may play an important role and may influence the global thermohaline circulation. So here you can see that global tides have a horizontal have scale about 100 or to 1000. And there is a cascade of mechanical energy which produces internal waves and baroclinic motions which may influence vertical mixing in ocean and in such a way have impact on climate. Here you can see the general structure of the vertical structure of the ocean. It is very well known that the upper layer is mostly is called mixed layer. Then you have a pycnocline and quite a sharp change in density. And after that, somebody can say that there is no almost stratification below this pycnocline. But actually, it is not true, because you have here two vertical profiles. One, the situation which would be the left hypothetical profile, which would be if we had not turbulent vertical mixing. Actual vertical profile of density is shown on the right hand side profile. And it is exponential stratification. It is, of course, much more sharp, much less sharp than the jump in pycnocline. But nevertheless, it plays an important role. Oceanologists say that inside in abyssal ocean, there is never find calm weather. Because on the surface, sometimes you have absolutely calm surface. It may happen, but in the abyss, in depths of the ocean, always you have some motion and sometimes amplitudes of the waves in abyssal the ocean are about 50 meters, 100 meters, even 200 meters. So you can, on the left picture, you can see the reasons for internal waves. They can be produced by surface effects, by winds, and also by interaction of tides or some bulk motion of the ocean with the topography of the bottom. And you can see that after interaction of tides with the topography of the bottom, you have cascade of energy which produce smaller and smaller waves, which can finally overturn and in such a way produce mixing. And it may end by turbulent mixing and dissipation. So in such a way, it impacts, it have influence of on the general circulation of the ocean. Here you can see the topography of the Brazil basin from the on the horizontal. In the horizontal direction, you have longitude, and vertical is bathymetry, so it's the depth. And you can see that on the left part of the picture, and the color here is diffusion. So vertical diffusion, vertical mixing. The left-hand side of this picture shows that there is no the topography of the bottom is quite sharp. You have a quite high level of diffusion, and not only near the, so you may think as a boundary layer, but through the whole depth of the ocean, you have intense mixing processes. So the topography plays an important role, and we will see that here important role plays the process of mixing induced by wave dynamics. Okay, so we will now from this general description of the ocean tidal currents, I will move to the quite simple problems. Later I will return again to oceanology. So we will consider now wave motions, mostly gravity waves and inertial waves, which occurs due to restoring force of gravity or inertial or Coriolis force. Of course, you know that if you will displace a particle from its initial state in stably stratified fluid to the nearby level, it will oscillate with the Brunt-Weissala frequency or buoyancy frequency. And the classical picture, it's a pity. It doesn't want to play full screen now. Okay, so the classical picture of the waves propagating from the wave maker is given by these classical experiments. You can see the beams of waves. What is important, internal waves are propagating always by beams, not just as plain waves. So group velocity here is very important. So this is an experiment which is made in Ecole Normale Supérieure de Lyon. If you have a tank filled with a stratified fluid and you will make small perturbations, the almost all wave energy will finally concentrate along a certain path. So you can see that in the beginning, all the tank is shaking. All the particles have almost the same amplitude. But finally, you can see that only particles are moving, which are locating near certain geometrical figure. And so this structure of this figure can change with change of parameters. Here, for example, you have the wave attractivism. Such a structure was named by Leo Maas by a wave attractor. So it's important to mention that there is no direct connection of this concept to the concept of attractor in dynamical systems. It's not just attractor, it's a wave attractor, what is important. So usually I have questions that why okay. Sorry. Okay. Why you have such a geometry that upper surface is shorter than bottom surface? The answer is that it is just a little bit more convenient to study such phenomena in experiments. And mathematically, it doesn't matter. Only direction of energy is nothing else. This is why quite often I will show you the pictures with such a configuration, like a right-hand side configuration. So we use the Navier-Stokes equations and in Boussinesq approximation. I will not stop in details on these equations. It's quite a classical theory. And also I will not mention the linear theory. I will only point your attention to the fact that for internal waves, frequency does not depend on length of wave vector as usual. Usually for acoustic and radio waves, you have radio waves, you have dependency of frequency on length of wave vector. But here frequency depends only on direction of wave vector. This is very, very peculiar and very, very strange from the common sense such a property, but and it defines strange phenomena, which you will see later. So because of such a strange dispersion relations and also some again strange consequences from billiard theory. If you will play billiard in confined geometry with such rules, you will finally get, almost always, you will finally get some geometrical figure to which all the wave beams will be attracted. So this is why Leo Maas, who is shown here, made gave this phenomena a name of a wave attractor. Okay, so this is already a numerical simulation of wave attractor, and here is the particular case. Wave attractor does not exist, but nevertheless, energy is here very high, energy of standing wave. It is a global resonance regime. I will mention it a little bit later. So we have such a geometry and we can parameterize it with the two parameters for ideal fluid. I will not explain now in detail the steps of this parameterization. I will only mention that you have finally basically two regimes possible. One regime is a regime without wave attractor. So it's usually if you have water, for example, in a glass or in a rectangular tank, if you have external forcing, you will have this standing wave, which is shown by blue here. So kinetic total, which is shown here, will change from zero to some level and again to zero. This is absolutely reasonable, quite, you can understand it with common sense. So no problem with blue behavior. But red line here shows the existence of wave attractor. And here you can see that energy goes to some level and oscillates about this level. So here you principally have traveling waves. No, okay, so I will only show now that the distribution of kinetic energy over the two parameters I mentioned to you, these two parameters is given here. We made it recently with Maria Providuchina from Oceanology Institute, and here it is shown that in case of existence of wave attractors, energy is much higher, and also very high values of kinetic energy are along the global resonance. Okay, so I will not mention now the three-dimensional features of internal wave attractor because I don't have much time. I only will now show the, I will mention the numerical approaches. So here we have non-rectangular geometry usually for investigation of highly non-linear effects. Spectral methods are used, but here spectral methods are not just applicable because of non-rectangular geometry. So we used spectral element method. Here is an example of the spectral element mesh, and here is how points are inside such an, each element. So this is one approach, and it allows us to investigate highly nonlinear motions, bifurcations, and transition to instabilities, and so on. But such an approach is quite difficult to implement new physical effects, multi-phase effects, sedimentation, and so on. So at the same time, we develop another approach based on finite volume approach. But it turned out that the solvers, which are implemented in open form, do not catch very well the solution. And if we compare with compare it with the spectral element simulations of high resolution. So used the quasi-hydrodynamic approach, and here are results obtained by Daniil Rizanov and Kirill Vatutin with the help of already the quasi-hydrodynamic approach. The comparison now is much better than with the conventional solvers of open form. And here, actually, I had a question during the second presentation, I think, about sedimentation processes. So maybe we can collaborate on the subject of sedimentation. I'm not sure if now the presenter of the sedimentation, there was a sedimentation presentation, and I think it would be a good idea to try such phenomena associated with wave attractors and implement some sedimentation approach to account for sedimentation, because it's actually have great practical interest. I will mention it later. So here is one of our first simulation with the help of spectral elements. You can see how attractor is formed. Later we investigated the instability of wave attractors. So I will skip it all. Then for the first time we made a 3D numerical simulation which coincided quite well with experiments. Okay, so and investigated spectral properties. What is very important, spectral properties of wave turbulence on the background of wave attractors. So it turned out, I will not make a description of these pictures. It's just a bispectra on the right-hand side, Fourier spectra on the left-hand side. But the conclusion is that we have a cascade of triadic subharmonic resonances. Well, it means that from the here is external forcing, and it gives birth to two daughter waves, subharmonic. So their frequencies are less than a parent harmonic. So, and after that, we have a cascade of such, these triadic resonances. So this is a particular feature of wave turbulence on the background of wave attractors in low aspect ratio systems. This is very important. This already published. We published it in last year and in 2016. But now I will mention later that these results are, of course, they are correct, but they are not often applicable to real ocean applications, because in real ocean applications we have large aspect ratio geometry, and there superharmonic instabilities prevalate, not subharmonic, what is important. Next, I will mention another topic which is closer to ocean applications, is when we have localized wave maker, but nevertheless, so you can see here that we have source of we have source of waves only part of the wall, but nevertheless we have almost two-dimensional structure. But it is not actually two-dimensional, and here we have lots of associated phenomena. I will not mention it now. And now I will mention the real situation, which was investigated and published by authors from China Ocean, First Ocean Institute and Ocean University, by these authors. It's about Luzon Strait geometry. So you have bathymetry, the plot of depth, and they investigated possibility of wave attractors formation in such a geometry. So this is another subject of collaboration, I think. And also it was published by Thomas Peacock and Wendell Tang, also for in application to Luzon Strait geometry. Okay, another topic we investigate important is when you have several forcing, external forcing frequency. This is what we this research we make with Daniil Rizanov. Okay, I will not stop on that now. And the next is the rotating systems. Here, quite a remarkable fact is when you have uniform and rotating tank of fluid, well, here you have wave maker located at the bottom. You also can get very nice attractor. Oh, he is a lazy instability, and he is a horizontal cut. Actually, it's very nice attractor. But what is a remarkable, absolutely remarkable phenomena? If you have, if you change a boundary condition conditions on lateral walls from no slip condition, you have absolutely different picture. It's also some kind of attractor, but not so so sharp. And actually here you have more standing waves than traveling waves. And if you make horizontal cut, it looks like this. So you can see here also not a pattern of traveling waves, but standing waves. And it immediately reminds about amphidromic points in ocean. Well, for example, you can see here the presentation how tidal motions around amphidromic points. So it's quite similar to what we get here in very simple situation. Okay, so I want to finish quite quickly, and I want to only to tell also that we had a regime of wave attractors in 3D rotating geometries. It's some kind of analogy to geophysical layer, rotating layer, and also studied instabilities. Okay, so here many results. I will just make a general impression of importance of it. So here is the transition to turbulence in with axisymmetric perturbations, and then quite a beautiful final turbulent regime. And what is important? This picture. What is important? That if you will look on the Earth atmosphere, atmosphere of the Earth from the North Pole, for example, you will see Rossby waves. And what we got in our numerical experiments that after initial transition to turbulence, small scale turbulence, there is an inverse cascade of gives rise to bigger structures which are moving. Here is vorticity. You can see that some vertical structure, large scale structure, which are drifting. This regime reminds topographical Rossby waves. The number of these structures changes with growth of amplitude. Okay, and I will finish with another application to oceanology. There was a work in General Fluid Mechanics in 2016 that for typical ocean topography, there may happen about 10 wave attractors. And our latest research concerns large aspect ratio systems. And we make it now with Kirill Vatutin, Stepan Ilizarov, Ilistratov. You can see here that from the first glance, it's just turbulent regime. You don't see here any attractors. But if you think so, you are completely wrong. Because if you make a plot of kinetic energy in this regime, 700 times higher than with the regime without wave attractor, for example, in a rectangular tank. So even if you from the first glance cannot see the attractor in ocean, measurements, it doesn't mean that it is not important. Actually, it gives rise to turbulence for particular geometry. So I think it's quite important to, we have modeled it for some quite simple geometry, suggested by Leo Maas, and now we make it for large aspect ratio systems. But it will be quite to make measurements in different parts of the ocean maybe and compare it with numerical simulation and make some conclusions about properties of turbulence. For example, we got here the spectrum, which shows us that supercritical harmonics are quite important. Here is prevailing instability is supercritical, not triadic resonances. And finally, it may result in correction of vertical diffusion coefficients, which are used in global circulation models. So the global results from this system may be the conclusion about how the vertical mixing can be corrected in different parts on the ocean or in some particular geometry. Here are two major major direction of the investigation. One is just classical, already becoming classical wave attractors, very well formed, and turbulent regimes on the background of these wave attractors. Okay, here's several pictures. So thank you. That's all. If you have questions, please ask.
Questions, please.
And thank you for your presentation. And actually, in our university, we have other group who working also working on internal wave. And I actually want to ask a question about the prediction of internal wave, especially for relatively small region, because there is a quite a big concern for offshore industry. For example, for submersible platform. Operations, the one of the biggest threats for them is the unpredictable internal wave, because the machine cannot respond this internal wave in time, and it might be damaged the whole platform. So have you thought about this prediction thing?
I think it's personally I didn't investigate such things, but I think yes, it's important. It's another subject of research, and I think it's important, yes.
Okay, thanks.
So we have listened to six presentations, three from Ocean University and three from ISP RAS. And now we have time for discussion. Maybe someone say some concluding remarks. Sergei, can you tell something? Sergei?
Hello, this is Sergei Strizhak. So I think that we have to be focused to define one topic for collaboration for a future proposal for Russian-Chinese grant. So I think this is the main important thing. And we have six different topics, and so we need to define one of them. One of the potential topic, as I understand, maybe it's concerning internal waves or maybe influence of internal waves on marine structures, maybe one of potential topic. Why not? Because we did not present today a lot of information. But as I understand, we also studied internal waves inside the special domain or numerical domain, and maybe why not to be focused on influence of waves or internal waves on marine structures. Or maybe another potential topic, it's regarding our Lib acoustics library, and to be more focused on IR acoustics. It's my ideas. So
can I correct hydroacoustics?
Yes, hydroacoustics. Yes, because we don't have enough time, and we need to define a single topic, and maybe try to think a little bit, and then approve, confirm, and then try to prepare a proposal. And this is important because we don't have enough time. Maybe 1 month, 1 month, and 2 weeks, maybe.
Can I, Sergei? Can I augment you? What I see from our workshop that we have two groups. And one group is very strong in physical experiment and engineering and numerical simulation. I'm talking about Ocean University. And second group, ISP RAS group, has strong competences in numerical simulation and software development. And maybe we can think about collaboration where we take experimental facility from Ocean University, IS tools to make some efficient simulation tool. So it's just a global idea.
Yes, I agree, but don't forget that we have a small project for 2 years, and we need to understand.
Yes, I understand. Uh-huh.
I also propose, of course, my topic, after presentation of Bo Young, I think. We can actually collaborate over the sedimentation processes on the background of wave attractors. So this subject has a particular interest, I think, in France. They will make soon experiments, maybe. So this is a subject which has practical interest, and in the UniCFD laboratory now, the code based on quasi-hydro dynamic equations is realized and works very well. We saw today presentation about sedimentation processes. So my question is whether it's possible. What do you think? Whether it's possible to apply the sedimentation solvers and these sedimentation approaches, combine it with the internal waves modeling with in quasi hydrodynamic approach, and in such a way we may real time make some investigation and publish it maybe.
Sergei, okay, I'm sorry, please continue.
Yeah, thanks for all your suggestions and comments. Actually, personally, I totally agree with you. And all these topics are fantastic, and we can cooperate, it's no problem. And we have test facilities, and we also want to work on sediment transport, even acoustic, all internal wave. For this small collaboration project, for quite small oncoming project, in Chinese part we have one limitations. We have to based on the ongoing NSFC fundings. My ongoing NSFC fundings is working on marine propeller and the propeller wall interactions. So maybe for this project, we can think about something related to the marine propeller or propeller wall interactions. And this one thing I can think about is for this POD and DMD analysis. In my ongoing NSFC fundings, I already mentioned we were working on this POD or DMD analysis, and we actually working on it based on MATLAB. But for your side, you're working on it based on the open form. You implement this analysis method in open form. So ideally, it can be on-fly processing. It can be processing during the simulations, right? So it's some kind of improve about this method utilities.
Yes. Start from we can start with implementation of DMD
for open form, for example.
For yeah, for that's only the rough idea. Or any idea related to marine propeller is okay.
What do you think about application of actuator model for propeller simulation?
What model? Sorry,
actuator model for propeller simulation. I think it can be very efficient because it allows to not to use AMI, and it will speed up your computations.
Yes. I agree with you. Actually, why first to learn how to do this marine cluster simulations, the first thing I learned is to learn from wind farm industry. Actually, blend test, I also read the paper, and for this American code, I also tried that code before. I think this actuator line model is might be more fit for this wind farm case because the wind farm blade is quite thin and long, but for the propeller case, the blade is too fat. It might be better with the actuator disc model, and this actuator disc model is relatively old, actually, but also other people already implemented in open form. I never tried that before. Maybe good try.
Yes, because Sergei has a lot of experience in using SOFA library, and the grant could be dedicated to research on how to use momentum sources instead of direct representation of blades.
Okay. There are already two research points.
Can you write these points maybe to disseminate them later after the seminar?
Yeah.
Okay. Or can I ask someone to do it? Sergei, can you propose something else?
I suggest that each team, I mean Chinese team and Russian team, after this workshop suggest three different topics and just maybe provide just one sentence or several sentences or small part just with a short description of this topic, just to have some explanation or definition of the goals and tasks. And then we have to share this information. And then after we have to think and select the best topic, which is interested for both teams, because we have to select only one scientific research problem, and we have to work like a joint team, and we have to prepare a joint plan for 2 years. And this is important, just to plan our work, that we have the same problem or the same research topic, and maybe we study different aspects of the problem, but we work like a joint team.
Sergei, I totally agree with you. Maybe we must point date to which we can gather these proposals. Maybe next week, for example.
Yes.
Yes. So Thursday of next week is a due date to gather proposal for titles and abstract for work, for future work.
Yes.
Dr. Chinzhen, what do you think? Okay.
I agree with that, and Because as I mentioned before, because in Chinese side, we have this kind of limitation only for this small joint project. After we get this small project, we actually can point any directions we want in the future bigger project. And any proposal or any idea have to relate it some kind, somehow to relate or cluster. That's my only concern. And for the other things about this conference you mentioned before, which will be held at the end of this year. Is there any update for this conference? I don't know whether it can be operation on time.
I think the conference will be the first week of December.
Yeah.
There were a meeting with our director, and he told that the conference will be despite any circumstances.
But, because we try to register it for the conference, but we cannot find the
registration. Okay, the site is a bit outdated because it's written here the conference will be on 2019. So mm-hmm. I will ask our scientific secretary about registration for this year.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay.
We will try to go to Moscow to have a face-to-face meet. No matter we get this funding or not, I want to continue this cooperation.
Yes, I think that's a good idea.
And how's the situation in Moscow? Actually, next week our students will come back to university, gradually come back to universities, and we will recover to more life now.
Sergei, do you have update about the situation in Moscow?
We now work from home remotely. So we don't have now any ideas and plans when we come back to normal, real working conditions. So now we are in Moscow. All of us are from Moscow. One colleague now, he is from Novosibirsk, from Siberia. And in Moscow, we have now a complicated situation, but let's say it's stable. Hopefully we are on at the stage of plateau, but we have to look a little bit, and we don't know. we can't say now when we come back to a real working conditions. We hope it will be maybe starting from July, maybe. But we will see.
Mm-hmm. Let's finger cross. I think everything will eventually will go back to normal. Don't need to worry about it. From our experience, take your mask and be careful. That's all.
Yes, thank you. So, I think that we have discussed everything, and we have to send each other our proposals regarding scientific topics. And as I understand, we have to do it on which day, Matvey?
We have to do it before next Thursday. So due date for proposal gather is 28th. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
28th of May.
28th of May, okay.
28th of May. Yes. Of May.
Okay.
So, colleagues, thank you for participation. At the peak, our workshop attracted 36 participants and 27 are now present. So I think this is a good result. Thank you everybody for coming, and I hope we'll see you later. Mm-hmm. Bye.
Yes, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Best wishes from Novosibirsk.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you, Sergei.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.